microphone, if that's all right. We are here to celebrate the life of John Peake. Big John, as many of you know him, I didn't know him as Big John. I just knew him as someone who made me laugh, as someone who challenged me with that. That's generous. Well, let me ponder that a minute. And then he would come back with, "So what do you think about this?" And he would go off on some far-off tangent. And the next thing I know, we would be way far off the subject that we were on. And I had no clue how we got there, nor how we would ever get back to what we were talking about. And I would say, "John, what in the world are you talking about?" "I don't know. Let me tell you a joke." "And no, never mind, I don't want to hear the joke." And that was John. And we would sit and we would laugh until our sides hurt. I'll share this one story before I read scripture and we have prayer and our praise and these things. We have a home church that meets on Thursday night, and it is made up of mostly women. And I say mostly because I attend it. So I'm the only male in the room. Too much estrogen in that room. Way too much estrogen. This one Thursday night, it met at John and Dawn's house. And John was not there yet. He worked late. He came in, and I happened to be sitting at their kitchen bar, and John had his back to the group, and I was sitting next to him. And there was a heavy discussion going on. And I didn't quite agree with what the ladies were saying. And I started to voice my opinion. And John very quietly said, "Shut up."
Discussions with Dawn about his relationship, or because we thank you for this time that we're able to celebrate John's life. Our hearts are heavy, sorrowful, because we're saying goodbye to a husband, dad, and a good friend. Brother, Father, we invite your Spirit into this place today. Move amongst us. Minister to us. Encourage us. Comfort us. Strengthen us. In Jesus' name.
spoke some time ago, and we asked each other to speak on this day for one another. And I guess John can speak on my behalf. So when we look at Big John, you just gotta laugh, because with the smile and the laughter that usually followed when he greeted me, John always had it. We all in this room have so many hilarious stories to share about John, because there is always something happening when you were with Big John. I joined Boy Scout Troop 33 about 42 years ago, and one of the very first campouts was at the Kiwanis Cabin. While we were coming back from hiking up Jacob's Ladder, John and some guys received our senior patrol leader, Michael Keith. They called him the Carrot Top. So naturally, I joined in, and naturally, for every action, there is a reaction. And I got head swearing in that. Big John came over to me and helped me up and said, "Don't worry, he's my big brother, and he's an asshole." So about that, you know, I even sang in the choir with St. Mary Magdalene's choir for a few years with the guy who hit me square in the nose. And I'm not even Catholic. But John and I did enjoy singing with each other, and we truly did. And 40 years ago, a song came out. And Lee Greenwood, "God Bless the USA," 40 years ago. So we did sing that. That was probably the first song that we sang together. We really liked that song. And I'm seeing a big comeback with that song 40 years later. And we sang that at Deer Creek Travel Park Campground Holidays in front of the band back in the 80s. Though we never made Star Search, never made The Voice, or American Idol, which I do like watching American Idol, we simply sang at family special events, weddings, graduations, and even funerals. So with that being said, I would like to ask my brother Brandon to come up to accompany me in a song that we feel is fitting for the special tribute to John's celebration of life today. The song is entitled "One Friend" by Dan Seals. This song also goes with the advice that John told me at this time of year, 28 years ago. Big John looked at me. "Hey, I can't be your best friend anymore." I also looked at him, so I said, "What are you talking about? What are you talking about? We're always going to be best friends." So they've got, "No, you're going to get married to Chris. She now is going to be your best friend. Dave, we're always going to be best friends. We're always going to be friends. But Chris needs to be your best friend." So with that being said, now I'm going to sing this song for you. Because John practiced with Chris. He is truly your best friend. Lord has.
Smile for me.
understands me and knows me inside out and helps keep me together and believes without a doubt that I can move a mountain, someone to tell to move. I had only one friend that I wanted to be yours. If we had only one friend that we wanted to be in helping out in the drop of a hat, and also Big John doing it his way. There are many more stories I could share, especially the Big John's Great White Hunter story, which I know some of this room knows what I'm talking about. That always took a part of me when I was instructing the Ohio Hunter Education course. What you might not know about me, I'm a retired natural resource officer for the Ohio Department of Natural Resources. And I would teach this course from time to time. And that story, if you want to hear it sometime, come to me, but it always is shared at the right moment when we're talking about firearms. So, and I did that a lot. But Dawn would like to give you and the audience a chance to speak, to share moments, stories about Big John. And we have a microphone right here that Pastor Rob's coming to. So if you would like to share a story about Big John, please come up to the microphone so all can hear, not only in this room, but on Facebook too as well. But I will caution you, and I've already asked the Lord for forgiveness. Try to keep this clean. If you cannot keep it, then I am just respectfully and done. speaking on behalf of Dawn here, right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Save it for
later. Save it at the training room. Okay.
You want to hear it.
All right. We can do it to anybody who has a soul. And come on up, Bobby. Come on, come on up. Just come on up. Make one.
Well, this involves. Back in 1987, West versus Reed, great football game, one of the best games ever played this day. We lost in overtime against Reed. To this day, me and John still argue about that. And when I get up in heaven, I guarantee we're still arguing about that. Well, Gene John was out there. Me and John, he was playing left. He was playing left defensive back. He was playing left guard. He looks up at me. He goes, "David, no, Frank, not coming." Knocked me right on my ass. And we was going on too. He just had 5 yard penalty on Reed. We got back down to the game, still at 2. And he hits me again. Another 5 yards on Reed. When he knocked me the third time, another 5 yards, I said, "Who the hell are you?" And he goes, "I'm John. You gotta be David." I said, "Well, Brandon, I'm his twin." "He never told me he had a twin."
Sometimes John and I would get a hold of the tape recorder. We had our own adventures. But one time playing back the tapes, you know, you hear Jenny's voice and she's telling the stories and news, whatever, going on in the middle of the sentence. "John Declan O'Keefe, put that knife down!" And then went back to the story.
Day that ever existed on the west side of Columbus when the sun itself would have been a cooler environment than Sacred Heart Church. And John and I were dressed to the nines, formal wedding, a little bit. Katie put me in bright pink because I would glow. John was nailed with his brother, and we, you know, we're big people. We have Hawk up. During this ceremony, since we're on the altar, it's a Catholic wedding, and as you know, you're kneeling, standing, sitting when we do this. But we didn't rehearse it, and we had no idea we were about to do it. And there were different times where John and I would go, because we'd be standing at the same time or kneeling at the same time, we had no idea we were just guessing. And, you know, that's not an ordinary story, but it was a proud moment for both of us to stand with Michael Katie. And we had the blessing of standing with Michael Katie for years, if not presence in our hearts. And I miss John because I didn't have to see him every day. But when I'd walk up, as I moved away for about 30 years, I came back and it's like I never missed a step. And I haven't seen Mrs. O'Keefe since maybe the passing of their father, but it was like I'd never left. John was like that too. The family just welcomes you and warms you, and that I will carry with me every time I think of John. He'll smile, and I'm proud to be a member of the family, and I'm very pleased to be with you. And today, I wish you every blessing in his memory. Thank you.
Tim McGee, I'm John's oldest cousin. And I was thinking I wouldn't have anything to share, really something funny. John was always there to help me move for some Kentucky Fried Chicken or some pizza. Or change an auto part in your driveway after dark with flashlights. And I always appreciated that, but I always thought I was do you remember this one time that I was sitting here? I was pretty hatchy with my cousin Michael a couple days ago. I think all of us, at one point or another, were involved in Irish step dancing. And we were out at the inaugural Columbus Fesh, Fesh's Irish Inlet for dance competition. And in between, Father Bennett, who later became Monsignor Bennett, got to St. Charles, initially came over and told us to get the leap off of the Grotto of St. Mary's not to play for prayer. And we let Father Bennett walk away and we continued to play.
just said it, I'm stupid. My cousin Johnny, and I did it. Well, Johnny never had anything on him that was important. Even until this point, I lied and he ran off on my Aunt Virginia. And brought her to where, you know, we're all in trouble. Now our parents are going to know where we're going. Brock goes to me, but instead, Johnny turns me in and it doesn't spit on me, Mom. She looks at him and says, John Declan McKee, don't you ever tell another lie about your cousin. She turned around and stormed off. Mad that we wasted her time. And Johnny, I'm sorry, got you in trouble that day when I deserved it. And I've made a promise to myself, I think I've kept it safe. Never do anything to disappoint my Aunt Jenny again.
I know the first time I ever met him, he knew the way to my heart as a fellow person who loves to eat their food. He bought me 2 funnel cakes at some festival, and I starved them down. I mean, they're wrong before you do it. And that's just one of many stories. At least it's saying he never hesitated. Those who issues and car breaking down that many times, and he would always be the first person there to help me out, drive me someplace, find me somebody to help me get it fixed, whether he was doing it himself. Whatever he could do, he did it. And he was there for, you know, all my games.
games, the football games, and I think he was over the moon when I decided to wrestle. My senior year, you know, that was a big thing. He was a big wrestler. And he loved football, but he also loved wrestling. And, he was a big part of that. He was always there for us, too. He's going to be missed. I'm sad as a receiver as he is. And my kids, Naomi and Micah, his grandkids, those were, you know, his from the start. Life is like, grandkids make life grand. They're not here right now, but that's one thing especially hard.
Every time we have Me and my handsome man, which I called him our because my God, was that guy handsome. The first moment we even talked on the phone, there was a soul connection. That first call went from 8 p.m. to 6 a.m. We didn't want to stop talking to each other. He was smitten right away, and I tried to say we would just be friends. But every time I talked to him or saw him, we didn't want to leave each other or stop talking. Very quickly, I agreed to a date, and from the moment he led me to the table at the restaurant with his hand on the small of my back, which he taught to do, I knew it was special, and I felt it all over. His touch felt like home to me. Didn't matter what or where, it made me feel safe, loved, protected, and cherished. And the kiss on my forehead, he regularly gave me said it all. We were extremely affectionate, extremely. Our hands fit together perfectly, just like our hearts. And the rest is the beginning of a beautiful and well-lived life, as we belly laughed until we cried every few days, being the sparkle of each other's eyes, finding new recipes to cook, and lots of fun and adventures. We are both very unique and well-rounded, experienced people who fit together like gloves. My handsome man and baby wanted me to have everything I ever wanted. He took extra special care of me. We were each other's family and everything. It was the love of a lifetime. Now my broken heart looks forward to the feel of his arms around me and the kiss on my forehead when we meet again. Live it up, baby. And know what we had was the best thing that ever happened to both of us. I love you forever and always with my entire heart. And these are some song lyrics. Now I know how the river feels when it reaches the sea and finally finds the place it was meant to be. He picked that song to be sang at our wedding. And then we would sing this together. We sang this at our reception, and it was our song. And every time we sang together, we sang it. It's your love. It just does something to me. It sends a shot right through me. I can't get enough. If you wonder about the spell I'm under, it's your love. I can't wait to look into those beautiful baby blues and hug you tight as I feel my home in your arms. Until then, I will put one foot in front of the other and learn to survive with this shattered and aching heart, or at least I hope I can. Thank you for the way that you loved me and took care of me. Thank you for the fun and the laughter. Thank you for the life and the family we built together. I will cherish my pics, videos, and memories forever. Thank you for the selfless way you lived your life and the way you loved our kids and grandbabies. You truly were the best, baby, and I will forever have a gaping hole in my heart where John Declan O'Keefe belongs.
Thank you.
To the other passage by Paul. Dawn loves to read the Apostle Paul. And I think her favorite book is Philippians. But I'm not reading from Philippians. Sorry, Dawn. I thought about it. I'm not reading from Philippians. I'm reading from Romans. And this passage jumped out at me. Says, who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Shall tribulation, distress, persecution, famine, or nakedness, or peril, or sword? He loved this, didn't he? I mean, you read over Philippians in your favorite passage, and it's a list, isn't it? He loved this, and he gives us this list, and he says, as it is written, we are accounted as sheep of the slaughter. Name all these things. We are more than conquerors through him that loved us. And then he says, for I am persuaded that neither death, nor life, nor angels, there's another list, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other creature, which shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. Do you think Paul understood what David wrote in Psalm 23? The Lord is my my shepherd, and because he is my shepherd, I am persuaded that there is nothing that can separate me from the love of God. I think that's why he wrote that. I think Paul knew it. And I think that's what he was seeing on. Now, I've shared this before because I've talked about this passage before, and some of you may have heard me talk about this passage before, but I've shared this before, that, and God forbid, David, that I don't get struck down in the Lord's house too, but I disagree with Paul. And I disagree with Scripture on this point. Because there is one thing that can separate us from the love of God. You and me. Yes, the Lord is a shepherd, and that's one of his names. But is he your shepherd? You see, what separates us from the love of God is you and your choice. You have to choose him. You have to choose to have that relationship with him. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not. You have to choose Jesus Christ. And if you choose Jesus Christ, then the Lord is your shepherd, and you shall not be in want. All of your needs are taken care of. You have victory over the tribulation of tomorrow. You have victory over the trials of tomorrow. He's already provided for what you need tomorrow. He's already provided for what you need today. Dawn, he's already taken care of tomorrow. He's already done it. But that choice is yours. And Paul knew that, and that's why I think Paul wrote, that's why I'm persuaded that nothing can stand against me. But that choice is yours. And I want you to know something today. Even though we're here celebrating John's life, this is a worship service. You can choose the Lord today in this place. We've told some great stories. And we've laughed and we've shed tears and we've cried and we've honored a great man. But this great man knew a greater man, and his name is Jesus Christ. Do you know him? Have you accepted him as Savior? It's very simple. Open the door of your heart. Revelation 3:20 says, "Behold, I stand at the door and knock. Anyone who opens the door will come in and suffer them." Open the door of your heart, and he comes in. Then you can say, "The Lord is my shepherd. I shall not be in want. I am persuaded that nothing can stand against me. He's not given me the spirit of fear, but of love and of power and a sound mind. I can cast all my anxieties on him and all my worries on him. And I can walk in victory today." But the choice is yours. What will you choose today? Let's pray together. Father, we thank you, Lord Jesus. We thank you that he came and he died on the cross for our sin, shed his blood, and that today we can have that relationship with you. That because of Jesus, we have access to the throne of grace. Lord, it's my prayer that if there's one in this place that doesn't know you as Savior, right now, this very moment, they would just simply say to you, God, I'm a sinner. Seems to share one more song with you, and then there's a couple of video slides. We're actually going to let John have the last word today. He always liked to have the last word. We're actually going to let John have the last word. And then after the video presentation, Angela worked very hard. All of you bombarded her with lots of pictures, and she worked very hard putting together a video presentation. And after that, we are going to take some time and set up some tables and watch Smoking Meats. Yes, she is related to me. Watch Smoking Meats has provided us their meal this afternoon. We invite all of you to stay. Participate before we head over to the Shamrock and tell the other stories. Okay? But if you can accept that Christ, keep him clean. Okay? Thank you all for coming and honoring the great man. And let's continue.